Hello everyone, let us look at the fundamentals of linear algebra as part of our course digital image processing. We will look into very few details that we need for our course. Above you of today's session, we will see multiplication of a matrix with a vector, multiplication of matrices, and then matrix decompositions or factorizations, followed by few important definitions. First one, multiplication of a matrix with a vector. As an example, let us consider the matrix A, which is equal to 1, 3, 2, 4, and a vector X, which is equal to 1 and minus 1. Let us call the vector Y as the resultant vector. Y is equal to A into X. 1, 3, 2, 4 multiplied with 1 minus 1. So, the first element is obtained by 1 into 1 plus 3 into minus 1, and the second element is obtained by 2 into 1 plus 4 into minus 1. We can split this into 1 into 1, 2 plus minus 1 into 3, 4, which will result in minus 2 and minus 2. We can see that the resultant vector is a linear combination of the columns of A. It means that it belongs to the column space of A. Let us see what actually happening to the input vector X. When we multiply the matrix A with X, the vector X undergoes two modifications in order to become the resultant vector Y. This is the input vector X, which is 1 and minus 1. This is the input, this is the resultant vector Y, which is minus 2 and minus 2. We can obtain Y from X by rotating the vector X with an angle theta and then scaling it with a factor, with a scalar factor, of course. So, when we multiply the matrix A with X, X will undergo two things. One is a rotation and then a scaling. It is interesting to see when only rotation will happen and only scaling will happen. Only rotation will happen if the matrix is a unitary matrix, and it will result in a vector Y which is having same length as that of X. Only scaling will happen if the vector X is an eigenvector of the matrix A. Only scaling means the X and Y, the vectors X and Y, they differ in lengths only. The directions of X and Y will be same. These two cases are very important to a signal processing engineer, because the first one talks about unitary transformations, and the second one talks about the most important transform, which is DFT. We will see that in the second chapter. The next thing is matrix multiplication. Let us consider two matrices, A equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and B equal to 1, 1, 1, minus 1. The question is, can we multiply any two matrices? No, we cannot actually multiply any two matrices as per our wish. If we want to multiply two matrices, we can only do that if the number of columns of the first matrix is same as the number of rows of the second matrix, and the resultant matrix will have same number of rows as that of the first matrix and same number of columns as that of the second matrix. If the matrix A is of size m by p and the matrix B is of size p by n, then C will have a size of m by n. It means that it will have m rows and n columns. So let us see how we can compute an element in matrix C. Let us say Cij is the element of C in ith row and jth column. The element Cij can be obtained by the dot product of the matrix, the dot product of the ith row of the matrix A with the jth column of the matrix B, which can be expressed as Cij equal to summation over k equal to 1 to p A of I comma k multiplied with B of k comma j. Here we can see that this index is running on the ith row of A, and this is running on the column, the jth column of B. So it is the dot product of the ith row of A with the jth column of B. We can obtain the entire matrix C by these dot products. The first element, the element in first row and first column of C can be obtained by the dot product of first row of A with the first column of B, and the element in first row and second column of C can be obtained by the dot product of first row of A with the second column of B, vice versa. It is interesting to see that the columns of C are the linear combinations of columns of the matrix A. For example, C1 can be obtained by multiplying A with the first column of B, which is the 1 and minus 1. So this is linear combination of 1, 3 and 2, 4, which will result in minus 1 and minus 1. Similarly, C2 can also be expressed as linear combination of the columns of A, which are 1, 3 and 2, 4, which will result in 3 and 7. So the columns of C are linear combinations of the columns of A. Similarly, we can express the rows of C as the linear combinations of rows of B. The first row of C can be obtained by multiplying the first row of matrix A with the matrix B. So this can be expressed as linear combination of the rows of B. Here this can be expressed as 1 into 1 1 plus 2 into minus 1 and 1. Similarly, R2 can also be expressed as 3 into 1 1 plus 4 into minus 1 and 1. Hence the rows of C are linear combinations of the rows of B. The matrix multiplication can also be expressed as sum of outer products. The matrix C can be expressed as outer product, the sum of the outer products of the first column of A with the first row of B and the second column of A with the second row of B. So one can see that this is also resulting in the same matrix, which is minus 1, 3 and minus 1 and 7. So let us move on to the next thing, which is matrix decomposition. We will see what is a matrix decomposition and why it is needed. Linear algebra is all about solving for the system of equations Ax equal to b. Ax equal to b is representing a linear set of equations. It can be, this system of equations can be solved by x is equal to A inverse into b. So solving for x involves computation of inverse of a matrix, which is computationally very expensive and complicated. With the present day computers, it is a difficult task to do. So what we try to do, we try to express the matrix A as product of matrices whose inverses can be computed easily. For example, if I write the matrix A as product of unitary matrices and a diagonal matrix, then computation of the inverse of the matrix will involve computation of scalar values and computation of transpose of the matrix, because the inverse of a unitary matrix is simply the conjugate transpose of the matrix itself. And the computation of a diagonal, inverse of diagonal matrix involves inverse of the diagonal elements of the diagonal matrix. Because of this reason, we need to use the matrix decompositions. Examples of such matrix decompositions are LU decomposition, QR decomposition, Cholesky decomposition, Eigen decomposition, Jordan decomposition, and singular value decompositions. Out of this, singular value decomposition is the most useful thing for a signal processing engineer that we will see in the next chapter. So in this session, we will see LU decomposition and the eigenvalue decomposition. What is an LU decomposition? Any square matrix can be decomposed as A equal to L into U, where L is a lower triangular matrix and U is a upper triangular matrix. Actually, you are very familiar with this. You used to compute the row echelon form of the matrix A. The row echelon form of the matrix A can be computed by multiplying a lower triangular matrix with the matrix A. This is expressed as L1 into A is equal to U. So A is equal to L1 inverse into U, which is equal to L into U. Here L is equal to L1 inverse, which is again a lower triangular matrix. So computation of inverse of lower triangular matrix and upper triangular matrix is much more easier when compared with computation of the inverse of the matrix A. LDU decomposition is closely related to LU decomposition, where the upper triangular matrix U is again decomposed into a diagonal matrix multiplied with an upper triangular matrix. The next thing is eigen decomposition. Before going to the decomposition, let us see what is an eigenvalue and eigenvector. A vector x of size n by 1 is an eigenvector to the matrix A of size n by n if it satisfies A into x is equal to lambda into x. Any square matrix A with linearly independent eigenvectors can be decomposed as A equal to phi lambda phi inverse, where phi is a n by n matrix whose columns are eigenvectors of A, and lambda is a diagonal matrix whose diagonal elements are the corresponding eigenvalues of A. If A is further a Hermitian matrix, then the matrix phi will be a unitary matrix, which means that phi inverse is equal to phi star transpose. So let us consider xi, where I is varying from 1 to so on n, denote the eigenvector of the Hermitian matrix A. Then A into xi should be equal to lambda I into xi. If I write the set of vectors xi as columns of a matrix, then A into x1, x2, so on, xn is equal to lambda 1, x1, lambda 2, x2, so on, lambda n, xn. Which means that A into phi is equal to phi into lambda. If we multiply this expression on either side with phi star transpose to the left, then it will result in A equal to phi lambda phi star transpose. Similarly, if I multiply this expression with phi star transpose on the left, then I will get lambda equal to phi star transpose multiplied with A phi. Let us see an example of eigenvalue decomposition. Consider the matrix A equal to 1, 0, 0, 1, 2, minus 1, 8, 0, 3. The eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the matrix A can be computed by solving the characteristic polynomial determinant of A minus lambda equal to 0. For this matrix, we can easily compute the eigenvectors, because the determinant of A minus lambda I is simply 1 minus lambda multiplied with 2 minus lambda multiplied with 3 minus lambda, which will result in the eigenvectors to be, eigenvalues to be 3, 2, 1 in the descending order. Hence lambda equal to 3, 0, 0, 0, 2, 0 and 0, 0, 1. We can compute the eigenvectors of the matrix A by using a minus lambda I multiplied with x equal to 0 and reverse substitution. So phi will be 0 minus 0.7071 and 0.7071. The second eigenvector is 010 and the third eigenvector is 0.1543 minus 0.7715 and minus 0.6172. Here one can see that all these three are orthonormal eigenvectors. Let us move on to the next thing. The next thing is about few important definitions. The first definition out of that is Toplis matrix. A matrix is called as Toplis matrix if it contains constant elements along the diagonals, both the main diagonal and the subdiagonals. So, in that case, if it is having constant elements along the diagonals, then the elements T of I comma j, they are characterized by the difference between the row index and column index. That is, T of I comma j will be equal to T of I minus j. Here one can see that in the diagonal element, in the diagonal of the matrix, the element is T naught. And for the first diagonal, it is T1. Similarly, for the diagonal which is, you know, below the main diagonal, it is T minus 1. The element is T minus 1 along this diagonal. So, we have same elements along the diagonals. Such a matrix is called as a Toplis matrix. Here, because we are having same elements along the diagonal elements, we will have only 2n minus 1 distinct elements, because the matrix will have 2n minus 1 distinct diagonals, instead of having n square elements, n square distinct elements. So, this is a Toplis matrix. A Toplis matrix is very important for us because it represents a linear time invariant system. So, the next thing is a circulant matrix. A matrix C of size n by n is called a circulant matrix if its rows and columns can be obtained by a circular shift of the previous rows and columns. So, C of I comma j equal to C of I minus j modulo n. Here, this modulo n is representing a circular shift. Hence, the matrix C of size n by n will have only n distinct elements. So, capital C, we can see here, the first row of this is C0, C1, C2, so on, Cn minus 1. The next row is simply a circular shift of the previous row, which is obtained by C n minus 1, C0, C1, C2, so on, C n minus 2. The next row will be again circular shift of this row, which is C n minus 2 coming here, and C n minus 1, C0, C1, so on, C n minus 3. And the last row will be C1, C2, so on, C0. Every circular matrix, we can see that it is a Toplis matrix because the elements along the diagonals are same. But the converse, which says that every Toplis matrix is a circulant matrix, is not true. Because any circulant matrix is a Toplis matrix, but a Toplis matrix need not be always a circulant matrix. So, let us move on to the next thing, which is a block matrix. A matrix curvy A, that is what I generally call that, is said to be a block matrix if all the elements of the matrix are matrices themselves. Here we can see that curvy A equal to A11, A12, so on, Am minus Amn, and all these elements are again matrices themselves. The next thing is a Kronecker product. The Kronecker product of two matrices A of size M1 by N1 and B of size M2 by N2 is defined as A Kronecker B equal to each element in the matrix A multiplied with the matrix B, which is A of 1, 1 multiplied with B, so on, A of N1 comma B, A of N1 comma 1 multiplied with B. And the last row in this block matrix is A of M1 comma 1 multiplied with B, B is missing here, so on, A of M1 comma N1 multiplied with B. This product is important for us, you know, for extension of the one-dimensional mathematics to the two-dimensional mathematics. If A and B are unitary, then A Kronecker B is also unitary. There are several other properties of Kronecker product which I am leaving to yourself to explore. The next one is norm of a vector. The pth norm of a vector x of size n by 1 is defined as the pth root of the sum of all the elements which are raised to the power p. So there are the three important norms, which is the first norm, which is simply the sum of absolute values of all the elements in the vector x, and the infinite norm is equal to the maximum value in the maximum of the absolute values in the vector x. And the second norm is the most important for us. It is simply the square root of the square of sum of the elements in vector x, which is also equal to simply the length of the vector. This can be extended to a matrix. The term matrix replacing the vector will give you all the definitions again. So the pth norm of the matrix A m by n is sum of it is the pth root of all the elements, sum of all the elements which are raised to the power p, and the important norms again define. So we'll stop it here for today's session.